Hello there, welcome to this new edition of World Panorama, where we get you a complete roundup and a perspective on all the big international developments this week. I'm Aishwarya Kapoor with you. Let us start the program with this week's top stories in the headlines. Future of Israeli government unclear after third election in a year. Prime Minister Netanyahu's Likud party gets maximum votes, but his coalition falls three short of majority in the 120-seat parliament. President to take a decision by 17th of March. As coronavirus infections cross 1 lakh globally, WHO warns spread of virus is not a drill, calls for significant action to contain the outbreak. Italy reports biggest daily jump in death toll. A week after signing peace deal, Taliban ramps up violence against Afghan forces. US conducts first air strike on Taliban since deal. Developments highlight fragility of the peace deal. A child drowns, three migrants die in border clashes as Greece seeks to stop inflow of refugees into its territory. This after Turkey opens its borders, says it can no longer be the gatekeeper for Europe. And Joe Biden roars into contention in Democratic presidential primary on Super Tuesday, wins most delegates. Now Trump's challenger two-way race between Joe Biden and Bernie Sanders. Senator Elizabeth Warren ends her presidential campaign. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu's Likud party has emerged as the largest party in the country's third election in under a year. However, Netanyahu's right-wing bloc failed to secure a parliamentary majority. With 99% of the votes counted, Netanyahu's Likud party was on track to win 36 seats and allied right-wing and religious parties another 22. Now, that would leave them three short of a majority in the 120-seat parliament. Likud is also now encouraging defections from the rival centrist Blue and White Alliance, which is set to win 33 seats. The Arab minority is also set to come third with 15 seats. Israel president has now 17th of March to decide which party he will assign the task of forming a government.
Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu coming out ahead in Israel's third election within a year. In the early hours of Tuesday morning at an election party in Tel Aviv, Netanyahu told cheering crowds that his victory was sweeter than the first time he became the Prime Minister in 1996 because it was harder. However, the Prime Minister's Likud party still appeared short of vital seats for a majority coalition.
It's a victory against all odds. Our rivals said that the Netanyahu era is over, but we joined forces and turned the tables. We turned lemons into lemonade.
Under Israeli law, Netanyahu will have 28 days to form a government, or it will lead to the possibility of a fourth election this year. Regardless, the election result is a stunning turnaround for a man 2 weeks away from the start of a major criminal corruption trial. Netanyahu is expected to appear in a Jerusalem court on 17th of March on charges of bribery, fraud and breach of trust in three major cases. His main opponent, retired General Benny Gantz, leader of the centrist Blue and White Party, stopped short of conceding defeat. Gantz had focused his campaign on Netanyahu's alleged corruption and anti-democratic moves.
Netanyahu does not have mandate required to form a government. We will examine our path. We are committed to the state of Israel. We are committed to the public in Israel. We certainly respect the voters' decision.
Meanwhile, the politicians representing the country's sizable Arab minority also appear to be set for significant gains, possibly their best ever performance. The Joint List Alliance has been calling for people to vote for it as a protest against Netanyahu's racist campaigns. The party ruled out joining a government led by Netanyahu.
The Joint List has fulfilled the most important achievement in the history of the Arab politics movement by getting the highest number of seats ever. But there is bitterness because the Netanyahu's bloc of racism, fascism received maximum seats. Netanyahu can form a government if he gets 61 seats.
There were concerns before voting day that coronavirus fears and election fatigue would hit turnout. Those fears were quickly dispelled as officials said 71% of the electorate had voted. Israel has been in an extended state of political crisis for almost 12 months after two previous general elections in April and September failed to produce a clear winner. To end the stalemate, Netanyahu had sought to energize his hardline nationalist base with promises of land grabs from Palestinians. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
The Director General of the World Health Organization has warned governments that the continued international spread of the novel coronavirus is not a drill and will require significant action if public health authorities are to contain the deadly outbreak. The call to action comes as the global number of people infected by the virus is now more than 1 lakh, a grim milestone, with the self-sustaining clusters continuing to expand in South Korea, Japan, parts of Europe, Iran, and the United States. On Saturday, the death toll from the virus in Italy rose to 197 after the largest daily increase in fatalities there since the outbreak began. India, too, has so far identified 31 cases, the majority of which have been linked to travelers from Italy.
Global cases of coronavirus continue to rise, now nearly 1 lakh. While majority 80,000 are from China, attention has shifted to rapid rise in global cases. WHO says in some countries, the level of political commitment does not match the threat level.
This epidemic is a threat for every country, rich and poor. And as we have said before, even the high-income countries should expect surprises. The solution is aggressive preparedness. We are concerned that some countries have either not taken this seriously enough or have decided there is nothing they can do.
Health experts have suggested that newly emergent clusters in Europe and the Middle East could accelerate the global spread of the disease. In Europe, Italy remains the worst-hit nation. Iran is at the heart of the Middle East coronavirus outbreak, with about 3,000 cases and 107 deaths. Authorities have limited travel between major cities to curb the outbreak. Schools are also closed in the country until April. Many countries have shut borders with Iran or imposed travel restrictions. Another country greatly hit has been South Korea, with more than 6,000 cases. Half the cases have links to a religious group, which the authorities are investigating amid claims that it has been concealing lists of members and those who might be infected. Australia, in collaboration with the country's states, is creating a $1 billion fund to treat coronavirus patients. The country has recorded 60 cases of the coronavirus.
We are anticipating, although it's a demand-driven arrangement, the costs will be what the costs are. But we are estimating, based on the advice we have at the moment, that this could be as much as about $1 billion, $500 million each, that we would at least have to be allowing for. I hope it's not that much. It could be more. But we at least, I think, have to enter into these arrangements having some sense of the scale of what we're dealing with here.
The week also saw 11 deaths in the US, leading Washington and Florida both declaring states of emergency. One deceased man became infected aboard the Grand Princess, a cruise ship which made a round trip from San Francisco to Mexico last month. The passengers of the ship are now being restricted to their rooms for testing, with test kits being delivered at sea. U.S. House on Wednesday passed $8.3 billion bill to battle coronavirus.
The American people can take some comfort that the reality is today that the risk of the coronavirus to the average American remains low. And as we continue to take these steps, as Americans continue to take common sense practices to protect their own health, the health of their family, we'll work to keep it there.
International Monetary Fund also announced $50 billion of support for countries hit by the coronavirus. The organization also said the spread of the coronavirus will push 2020 global output gains to their slowest rate since the financial crisis in 2008.
What we are wrestling with is uncertainty, and that defines our projections, which at this point lead us to state that global growth in 2020 will dip below its last year's levels. But how far it will fall and how long the impact would be is still difficult to predict.
The virus's spread is having significant knock-on effects on the global economy and daily life. Markets worldwide have reacted negatively, forcing finance officials and central banks to take action. Government agencies and private companies across the globe have cancelled or pushed public functions. Many countries have closed major tourist hubs. Governments have shut schools, and sporting events are sometimes being played behind closed doors. Even courts in Seoul are holding video hearings. Travel and tourism has been among the most affected industries. International carriers are taking a similar hit. The outbreak could cost the airline industry as much as $113 billion in lost revenue. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
The United States conducted an airstrike on Wednesday against Taliban fighters in Afghanistan, who are accused of attacking an Afghan security forces checkpoint. The strike comes after Taliban resumed violence days after the U.S. and the Taliban signed a historic agreement in Qatar on Saturday. Earlier, Afghan President Ashraf Ghani rejected the prisoner swap clause of the deal. The developments have brought into focus the fragility of the peace deal, which is aimed at withdrawing of U.S. forces from Afghanistan and spurring the start of intra-Afghan negotiations.
The U.S. Taliban deal that was signed last weekend was hailed as historic. That aimed to end America's longest war. However, the week showed how fragile really the deal is. The militant group announced on Monday that while it would not attack foreign troops, attacks would continue on Afghan security forces. As a result, at least 20 soldiers and policemen were killed in overnight Taliban attacks on Wednesday.
I hope for a long-lasting peace in the country. I hope it won't be like the previous truce because I was shot at that time. Why don't the Taliban sit with Muslims, elders, and tell them that they want peace?
With the uptick in violence, President Donald Trump held a conversation with a top Taliban leader, later saying he had a very good talk and insisted the group wants to cease violence. But on Wednesday, the U.S. carried first airstrike on the Islamist militant group in Helmand Province, saying that the defensive airstrike was aimed at disrupting Taliban fighters who were actively attacking an Afghan security checkpoint. Wednesday's strike was the first by the U.S. against Taliban in 11 days, when a reduction in violence agreement began between the two sides in the lead-up to the Saturday's pact.
I would caution everybody to think that there's going to be an absolute cessation of violence in Afghanistan. That is probably not going to happen. It's probably not going to go to zero. So this is a significant step forward, this agreement, and it's going to lead to inter-African dialogue, and it ultimately leads to a peace agreement. But to think that it's going to go to zero immediately, that probably is not going to be the case.
The new deal is aimed at withdrawing U.S. forces and spurring the start of the intra-Afghan negotiations. After signing the deal, U.S. and Afghan officials had both said they expected that the reduction in violence that led up to the agreement would continue afterwards. But the text of the deal makes no mention of this. The ambiguity seems partly responsible for the confusing situation developing on the ground. In other signs of trouble for the deal, Afghan President Ashraf Ghani also earlier this week rejected the timeline of another key element of the agreement, a prisoner swap that includes the release of up to 5,000 Taliban fighters in exchange for up to 1,000 Afghan security forces. The Taliban have previously refused to negotiate with the Afghan government. So Saturday's deal was just with the US. Ghani said his government did not agree with the prisoner swap.
There was a request regarding the release of the Taliban prisoners, but it can only be part of the negotiations, and it cannot be precondition for starting the intra-Afghan negotiations.
The Trump administration is seeking an exit from the longest war in the U.S. history. With intra-Afghan negotiations due to begin next Tuesday under the terms of the agreement, U.S. Special Envoy Zalmay Khalidzad has traveled to Afghanistan to try to bring together the warring parties. But uptick in violence on the ground clearly shows it is going to be a long way ahead for peace to prevail in Afghanistan. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
Time now for a very short break, and up next, we'll tell you about the race for the White House. What happened on Super Tuesday, the most consequential day in the Democratic primary, which will play a key role in deciding who will be the Democratic candidate to take on Republican Donald Trump. Details coming up on the other side of the break. Stay tuned. A child drowned on Monday when a boat carrying 48 migrants capsized while trying to reach the Greek island of Lesbos from Turkey. It was the first confirmed death since Turkey declared late last week that it was ending its policy of blocking migrants trying to cross into Europe, saying it could no longer take in so many people who are fleeing the Syrian civil war. Turkey claims that three migrants were also killed in Greek border clashes. This, as Greece has deployed major military forces on the land and the sea borders it shares with Turkey to stop migrants. The Greece government also said that it would suspend asylum applications for a month and deport anyone arriving illegally.
Remember the shocking image of a drowned toddler washed up on a beach on the Turkish coast? That image drew attention to the perilous journey many Syrians took to flee civil war and reach the shores of Greece. 4.5 years later, on Monday, further north in the Aegean Sea, another child drowned off the Greek island of Lesbos after a migrant boat capsized. The child is the first fatality since Turkey reopened its border to let migrants reach Europe. Turkey had signed a deal in 2016 with the European Union in which it agreed to take many refugees from Syria. But renewed fighting in Syria means that more and more people are on its doorstep trying to get to safety. And Turkey has told the world it cannot take any more. As a result, it opened its border to let migrants go to Europe, a move that has led to a new flow of arrivals in Greek islands. Greek islands lie on the route which migrants take to cross the sea on the way to Europe. Greece police say that at least 1,000 migrants have reached its eastern Aegean island since Sunday morning. Greek authorities are already under pressure due to huge inflow of migrants and are now tightening border measures. Coast guards resorting to measures like shoving migrant boats and even opening fire to force the migrants to turn back.
Those that have entered Greek territory have been arrested and detained. And in my mind, this is an illegal way of entering one country.
But it's clearly
cutting borders.
It's clearly possible to get through.
Troubles are not over even for those migrants who are able to land on Greek islands. There are more than 40,000 migrants already living on Greece's Aegean Islands in severely overcrowded camps. Migrants on Greek island of Lesbos clashed with the police on Monday over conditions in the camp. Some 300 migrants threw stones and other objects at the police outside the camp. Police responded with tear gas and flash bombs. There are constant protests by migrants as well as local residents who want the camps closed.
We need a doctor. We didn't have a good doctor in inside Moria. This is very difficult for every one person. If we not have a good food, we didn't have a good water. We need the doctor. This is very important. This is very important for every one person. All of them baby have all cold problem. All of them baby have cold problem. In here we didn't have a good places. Moria is very dangerous. We live in the jungle. Maybe you know, jungle is very dangerous for every one person.
Greece government says it will close migrant camps that are already there on the islands, move asylum seekers to the mainland, return those who do not qualify for asylum to Turkey or the countries of origin. And for a few thousand newly arriving migrants, new reception centers on the islands are being made, in which migrants' movements will be restricted and their stay temporary. The plan has met with opposition from both migrants and locals, with clashes taking place on the Greek islands. And things are expected to worsen with the arrival of more migrants in the days to come. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
And here is a look at some more international news stories in Global Buzz. Sri Lankan President Gotabaya Rajapaksa dissolved parliament late on Monday, and the Election Commission announced a general election for 25th of April. Rajapaksa won the presidency last November and named his elder brother Mahinda Rajapaksa as interim prime minister. The election could help the Rajapaksas to strengthen their hold over the island of 22 million people. The president is empowered by Sri Lanka's constitution to dissolve parliament any time after completing 4.5 years of a 5-year term, which Rajapaksa did on Monday. Residents in Colombo welcomed the dissolution of parliament. The new parliament will meet on 14th of May. Malaysia's Muhyiddin Yassin, a Malay nationalist politician backed by the corruption-tarnished former ruling party, was sworn in as the prime minister on Sunday. This after the king picked him to replace 94-year-old Mahathir Mohamad. The swearing-in capped a week of turmoil that began with Mahathir's resignation in an apparent bid to consolidate power, but ended with him sidelined and complaining of betrayal after decades dominating Malaysian politics. Mahathir said that he felt betrayed by the newly appointed Prime Minister. And NASA on Thursday announced the name of its next Mars rover, Perseverance. The name was announced at an event at a school in Virginia to congratulate Alex Zamata, the 7th grade student who picked the name. It will be NASA's 5th exploratory vehicle on the Red Planet. The rover will be launched between 17th of July and 5th of August this year. The window was chosen because the Earth and Mars are in good positions relative to each other at that point. Perseverance is projected to land on Mars in February 2021. Who among the Democrats will take on Republican Donald Trump in the 3rd of November U.S. presidential election? The nominees are being chosen through a series of primaries and caucuses in every U.S. state and territory that began in Iowa on 3rd of February and ends in Puerto Rico in early June. This week saw Super Tuesday, the big date in the Democratic primary calendar when 16 states, territories or groups voted for their preferred candidate. A third of all the delegates available in the entire primary season were up for grabs on Tuesday. And by the end of the day, it became clear that Joe Biden and Bernie Sanders are the frontrunners for the Democratic nomination.
U.S. presidential race becoming more interesting every day. On Thursday, Elizabeth Warren, the Liberal Massachusetts senator whose sweeping economic plans shaped the Democratic policy debate, dropped out of the race. Warren was the last major female Democratic presidential candidate in the race. So the US will elect its first woman president someday, but it will not be in 2020. Warren's departure setting up what is effectively a contest between two white men in their 70s, Joe Biden and Bernie Sanders.
I will not be running for president in 2020, but I guarantee I will stay in the fight for the hardworking folks across this country who have gotten the short end of the stick over and over. That's been the fight of my life, and it will continue to be so.
Earlier, on the biggest day of voting in the 2020 Democratic primary, on Super Tuesday, Joe Biden regained his status as a front runner, winning 10 of the 14 states that voted to pick a Democratic presidential nominee. Biden, who is popular with African American voters, was victorious in a line of states across the South, including Texas, which is crucial to the race because of its high number of delegates. Billionaire Michael Bloomberg, who had spent millions of dollars on advertising, was unable to clinch a single state victory and dropped out of the race and endorsed Biden. Biden later called voters to join the movement to beat Donald Trump.
And this is a movement we are building. It is a movement. And we need that movement to beat Donald Trump and to build a future we all know is possible. You know, I'm especially proud that our campaign is generating so much enthusiasm, driving up voter turnout all across the nation.
Biden's main rival, Bernie Sanders, had won in Colorado, Utah, and Vermont, the state he represents as a senator. He's also ahead in California, which has more delegates than any other state. Sanders lashed out at a political establishment he said was set on destroying his campaign. Depending on the outcome of the Super Tuesday and the delegate-rich primaries over the next 2 weeks, Biden and Sanders could be forced to slug it out all the way to the Democratic Party's convention in Milwaukee in July. Biden's allies, however, hoped that his momentum would become unstoppable and Sanders would continue to fade.
Our campaign is unprecedented, because there has never been a campaign in recent history that has taken on the entire corporate establishment. There has been never a campaign in recent history which has taken on the entire political establishment. And that is an establishment which is working frantically to try to defeat us.
It is noteworthy that US presidential nominees are being chosen through a series of primaries and caucuses in every US state and territory. That began in Iowa on 3rd of February and ends in Puerto Rico in early June. The Republican nominee will be Donald Trump. Even though technically he has a challenger, he's so popular among Republicans that he has a clear run ahead of him. So who will be the Democratic nominee to take on Donald Trump? We have to wait and watch. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
And finally, ahead of International Women's Day, Barbie has launched its new collection of female sporting role models. The collection sees multiple athletes transformed into dolls. The project, ahead of the 2020 Olympics in Tokyo, aims to build the self-esteem of young girls and help fight biases against them. The idea is to show girls that they can be anything they want to be. Well, that is how dolls really should be, isn't it? So take a look at this new collection of Barbie dolls. As I take your leave, I'll see you next week in another edition of World Panorama. Bye for now.